Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. On this very, noble location of the World Sight Day, this initiative by the Shankara Academy of Vision to commemorate the year 2020 by having 20 lectures of 20 minutes each, catering to the Hope in Sight initiative. Is an extremely important aspect related to, both academic and capacity building of professionals and the eye care community worldwide. Thanks for the opportunity. And I have the responsibility of going through the next 20 minutes, taking you through a presentation, basically catering to a very important aspect of any institute which undertakes not only academic activities but also research activities. And this is to do with reviewing a study protocol by the members of the ethics committee. Just to put it in perspective, if you look at ethics committee members and the ethics meetings per se, it draws from a lot of expertise across the board in order to make sure that we satisfy the requirements of the ethical aspects of a research study. In that context, what I'll try and do is I'll try and, in the next few slides, actually take you through what an ethics committee does, what constitutes an ethics committee, what are the ways they take a decision, and who is a part of the ethics committee, and also look at ways and means of what is the sort of oversight activity that does the ethics committee have for any institution that undertakes research. Basically, as Shankara Academy of Vision and Shankara Eye Care Institutions premierly is well known for its service delivery activities, but side by side, sitting on a gold mine of information and data, I think also pursuing this agenda of trying to propagate research as well as make sure that the larger eye care community is also benefited is as equally important in addition to the academics and service delivery activities. I guess this is a simple illustration of what basically research tries to do. It tries to identify the submerged part of a block of ice when it is put in water, or what is called as an iceberg, where what we know is only the 10%, and what we don't know is 90%. And this 90% actually is something which we try and understand by doing research in order to make sure that we inform the service community as well as we inform our practice. And that's precisely what research basically tries to do. But in order to bring forth to the fore the 90%, it's very important that we follow certain tenets of research. And in that context, I think the institutional ethics committees and the institutional review boards become extremely important. Just to tell you, I think research basically is carried out in order to generate reliable information for us to actually look at undertaking, measures to control a particular problem, both from the point of view of generating this evidence for decision making through trustworthy sources. And this evidence becomes very extremely important for us in order to make sure that we put in place management plans so as to drive public health policy, as well as in order to actually enable us to undertake rational planning, efficient utilization and evaluation of interventions. And if you look at the activities across eye care institutions, across the board, most of the eye care institutions do undertake all these three main objectives with respect to gathering reliable information, generating evidence for our own decision making, as well as facilitating rational planning and efficient utilization. And in that context, it's extremely important for us to answer this particular question. as much as healthcare or medicine that we practice is about can we, it's also important for us to consider ethics as an aspect of should we. So the question can we is answered by healthcare or you know the practice of medicine or an evidence generation mechanism, whereas ethics really answers the question should we. Should we undertake a particular research? Should we undertake a particular activity? Should we undertake evidence gathering? In that context, it's extremely important to understand, apart from the fact that there are certain moral obligations, certain legal obligations, ethics is at the pinnacle of any research that we undertake. And hence, it's very important for us to actually have you know, somebody who could understand or who could do this balancing act between what is science and what is really ethics, and for which we need a body which is independent in nature in terms of really trying to strike a balance between science and ethics. And that is where an institutional ethics committee, which is a British term, whereas the institutional review board, which means the same, one and the same, which is an American terminology, where the overarching agenda of both of these committees, whether you call it an institutional ethics committee or an institutional review board, is to make sure that we undertake ethical research in whatever we try to do to answer our particular objectives.
So what we basically are trying to do is we try and follow the ICMR 2017 guidelines, which has set out for us very clear sort of guidelines in order to make sure that we follow the tenets of ethical practice when it comes to research. And as I already told you, these are guidelines. When I say guidelines, they are not laws or they are not legislations. They are not written in blood or etched in stone, etc. Which means that these are guidelines, and these guidelines are a work in progress. As things evolve with respect to human experiments, and also these ethical guidelines also are sort of modified to suit that particular situation. So the box on the right side of my slide tells you what the requirements of the ethical committee members are. And these are all very well sort of outlined in this particular document, which is the ICMR 2017 guidelines. And these guidelines, called the National Ethical Guidelines for Biomedical and Health Research Involving Human Participants, very clearly outlines the functions, the responsibilities, the procedures, the processes, and the decision-making process of the Institutional Ethics Committee. I invite each one of you who participate as an ethical committee member to actually download a copy of this particular guideline and go through it from time to time, and also inform yourselves when you're part of this Institutional Ethics Committee. Just to give you an illustration, as you can see, the constituents of an Institutional Ethics Committee, which is as per the New Drugs and Cosmetics Rules, which is dated to March 2019, which follows the tenets of the Indian regulations of the ICMR guidelines, includes a chairperson, a member secretary, a legal expert, a medical specialist, a postgraduate is always preferable, a basic scientist who's a postgraduate or a PhD doctoral holder, a lay person, an external subject expert. From time to time, you can increase the numbers of external, subject experts who can help in terms of making a decision of a particular, proposal. And not to forget, a social worker or a theologist or a philosopher. And if you look at it very carefully, the ones which are highlighted in blue invariably have to be outside the institution. They should not belong to that particular institution. Can be from the institution, and male gender and the female gender with respect to the composition. But actually, when it comes to making a quorum in order to make a decision with respect to a particular proposal, the minimum requirement is the layperson, the basic medical scientist, a clinician, a legal expert, and a social scientist or an NGO or a philosopher or ethicist. These five people minimum should be there to ensure quorum in a particular, you know, sort of research proposal, and also to take a particular decision. Which means if you don't have at least these minimum people, and those people who are invariably from external to the system, then it's very difficult to have a quorum and then to conduct an institutional ethics committee meeting. So these five people are very, very critical. And if there is anybody within this group who has what is called as a proprietary or a conflict of interest sort of thing, they should inform the chairperson and recuse themselves from voting or making a, you know, making up this particular quorum. And it's a moral obligation on the part of somebody who has a conflict of interest. And every one of them, it's important that they sign the declaration and also declare the conflicts of interest whenever you sit for an ethics committee meeting. The primary purpose, no, I have tried to put this as a frequently asked questions, sort of, you know, trying to answer this question. The primary purpose of an institutional review board or institutional ethics committee and the review is to actually protect the welfare of the human participants, which means we also have institutional ethics committees for animal experiments. We also have institutional ethics committee, or what is called a specialized committee, for looking at, you know, very, very basic research called as stem cell research, etc. But from the point of view of human experiments, the overarching purpose of the institutional review board or institutional ethics committee is to make sure that you protect the rights, the safety, and the welfare of the human subjects. So do remember, it's primarily to assure the protection of rights, safety, and welfare of the human subjects. What are the sort of documentation which is required for an institutional ethics committee in order to make a decision? The documentation basically is falls into four broad aspects, and I've tried to summarize these four broad aspects or documentation into those documents which looks at the science behind a particular research. What is the sort of logic or science, the scientific basis behind that particular research, which means it also overrides the scientific committee recommendations, which means the institutional ethics committee can also question the scientific basis or the scientific committee's recommendation or technical review committee. So what are the documentation which is required under 01? It is the study protocol, the information brochure, if you have, with respect to any drug or medicine or device, etc. The case record files, the diary, as well as the questionnaires or tools of inquiry. With respect to looking at risks and benefits, it's extremely important that it should be spelled out within the protocol as well as the information brochure. In addition, it's very important that the ethics committee also looks at the capacities and capabilities of the team or the investigators, as well as the sites which are undertaking this particular research. For instance, documents like the curriculum vitae or the biodata of the investigators, their training, their certification, undertaking from those investigators with respect to why they need to be you know, doing this particular study, and do they have a conflict of interest, or they do they have a proprietary interest, etc., as well as the details of the larger team becomes very important in order to assess the institutional capacity with respect to undertaking this particular research, as well as the capability of the study team. Please do understand, this is something which you usually sort of assume when you are in an institution like the Shankara Eye Care Institution, right, where day in and day out you undertake research, clinical research as well as academic. So this is sort of an assumption. In addition, where we are very concerned with respect to, because primary responsibility is number four with respect to protecting the welfare of human part, which is nothing but informed consent form, right? So the information in the consent form, which should be in a language where it is understood by the human participant. So the informed consent form, as well as the diary, the tools, if there are any, sort of advertisements in order to make sure that you are trying to recruit participants, the aspects related to indemnity, insurance, payments, reimbursements, any material transfer agreements, memoranda of understanding, etc., has to be very clearly, presented to the institutional ethics committee in order to make sure that they are able to take a very, very considerate and, just decision with respect to any research proposal. So this is again subject to what are called as this, drug controller and general of India and the, aspects related to the guidelines of them. And also, if you are undertaking a clinical trial, it's very important for you to register under what is called as the Clinical Trial Registry of India, which is under the ICMR. So what do basically the Institutional Ethics Committee or the IRB member? So the Institutional Ethics Committee or the IRB looks at the scientific rationale and design, looks at the risks and benefits, looks at the informed consent process, and most important, looks at the participant protection aspects related to particular decision and research. So what is the basis for an institutional ethics committee or an IRB to be independent and unbiased? They should and look at the risk and benefit, and not to forget the consideration related to ethics with respect to protecting the human. So an institutional ethics committee has to follow these four broad principles with respect to being independent and unbiased, the science behind it, looking at the benefits versus the risk, as well as the ethical consideration. Apart from, the decision-making process within an institutional ethics committee, there is also another role which the Institutional Ethics Committee or the IRB undertakes. It's in terms of the mandate to look at the on-site review. They also have a mandate with respect to making sure that any research or study is going on the way it is supposed to be planned and approved. So how is the study going? Whether the site has any issues with respect to undertaking that particular study? What are the aspects related to participants' protection, and whether the risks and benefits or the risks actually have changed over a period of time is also a part and parcel of the mandate of the Institutional Ethics Committee. And they have a sort of overarching sort of mandate to also look at the on-site review of any particular research. I've tried to put this in terms of really a matrix. So why does the ethics committee need to go to a study site, or why do they have to actually look at the oversight aspects of a particular research? I don't want to go into being done, but this sort of slide summarizes the monitoring aspects, the audit aspects, and the inspection aspects. And if you really look at it, who is doing it, when it is done, where it is done, what is being reviewed, what are the standards of review, are all summarized. And if you look at the highlighted aspects of the mandate of the Institutional Ethics Committee, they do have some role in much more deeper aspect related to looking at it and inspection in terms of their activities. So an ethics committee is also mandated to look at aspects related to monitoring, audit, as well as inspection with this particular sort of a rubric in terms of the different aspects. So in order to actually give you an illustration with respect to the ethics committee and the role, if you look at the study participant as being the most important person or the very important person here when it comes to research for which the institutional ethics committee is set up, it's important to look at the risks, the benefits, the different alternatives, look at vulnerabilities, look at the understanding and also other aspects related to what a human ethics committee can do. And this gives you a very, very broad understanding. So informed consent, try and look at in order to protect the principally what the ethical considerations of any research is. So they also have a role in terms of looking at reporting and the safety aspects in the conduct of any research. So whether, there's a movement towards actually now doing accreditation of institutional ethics committee, and I recommend institutions like Shankara to actually go ahead and get their ethics committees also accredited by the agencies as we move forward and as more and more research happens, in terms of really looking at ensuring compliance to timelines, review for adequate medical management and compensation, looking at causality, as I said, insurance and compensation, and also making sure that the compensation are actually being paid. And this becomes a very important aspect related to ethics committees as well, when it comes to, adverse reactions, safety reporting, and all those aspects, because this also starts falling into the sort of bandwidth of the legal system. So for us in this country, the regulatory body or the licensing authority for most of our drugs and devices, etc., is the Central Drugs Standards Control Organization, which is headquartered in New Delhi, in short called as DCGI. And the law which overrides or governs this is the Drugs and Cosmetics Act of 1940 and rules of 1945 with amendments and the new Drugs and Cosmetics Acts of March 2019. So basically, looking at clinical trials and the schedules, etc., etc., this becomes very important when you're going into deeper aspects related to company-sponsored trials and those kind of things, where you have to really be a little more well aware of these aspects. But do understand, there are rules, there are regulations, there are acts, there is the law, and there is the overarching constitution. So these Drugs and Cosmetic Act or the new drugs and clinical trial rules of March 2019, which I was alluding to, very clearly tells you the regulations when it comes to undertaking clinical research, because part of the research which you will also oversee as decision makers when it comes to an institutional ethics committee is clinical research as well. This presentation, I have drawn a lot from the work which I was trained for by Dr. Ashish Rastogi, who belongs to CT Quest, a limited company, with in terms of really certifying us in good clinical practices and the International Commission or for Harmonization, etc., the ICH GCP guidelines, etc. And once again, I think it's an extreme pleasure for speaking to an audience like y'all, and I thank Shankara Eye, Shankara Academy of Vision, Shankara Eye Foundation on this very auspicious occasion of the World Sight Day 2020. for giving me this opportunity to be speaking to you about a very significant and important aspect of the role and responsibilities of an institutional ethics committee in terms of really looking at carrying out ethical research. Thank you very much.